Okay, welcome to the session on oxygenation and ventilation of the COVID-19 patient. This is module one, and we plan on going over non-invasive support as kind of an overview or a 30,000 foot view. The products that are shown here are for demonstration purposes only and the ones that I'm most familiar with. And so the AHA does not endorse or recommend any specific manufacturer or product. And so, and clearly a lot of things that you would normally do for taking care of patients, we always recommend personal protective equipment such as gloves, mask, and shield. And then we'll talk about a little bit more about the airborne stuff with wearing N95 mask or PAPRs. So trying to give you an overview, we've designed this to kind of provide just-in-time training for the non-ICU healthcare provider. Those just either don't work in the ICU on a regular basis, or we're actually pulling you in from retirement or outpatient settings to help us in the ICU with these very sick patients who require ventilation assistance for either the investigation of or the confirmed cases of COVID-19. And so we're trying to be very specific to that particular disease. And then additionally, we want obviously you to protect yourself, and we want to try to provide you with as much information as we possibly can to risk mitigate the use of such devices like non-invasive ventilation and high flow nasal cannula. And then we'll kind of briefly review the benefits and functionalities of these non-invasive ventilation and high flow nasal cannula devices. For some of you guys that have been out of the ICU setting for a while, high flow nasal cannula, for example, might be actually new to you. So let's first start with risk mitigation. So when we're attempting to use ventilation equipment, we want to try to use the method that produces the least amount of aerosol generating. And so one of the things that you'll hear frequently in the literature about the COVID-19 patients is aerosol generation or procedures that produce an aerosol. And so non-invasive positive pressure ventilation and high-flow nasal cannula have a higher risk of generating aerosols. To what extent, we're not exactly sure, but it's something that we want you to be aware of, and that we also try to recommend protecting ourselves from it. So if you're using non-invasive ventilation or high-flow nasal cannula, the room needs to have full airborne precautions because of that aerosol generation. And preferably even a negative pressure room would be beneficial. But we're also a realist that in this kind of pandemic with lots of cases and those types of things, there may not be enough negative pressure rooms to be able to do that. So if you're initiating non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, then we want to make sure that the highest level of approval is obtained. And we strongly recommend avoiding kind of non-invasive ventilation in these cases, if at all possible. Certainly there are exceptions. And so if they do have a do not intubate with acute indications for non-invasive or high flow nasal cannula, patients who use non-invasive chronically, so a neuromuscular patient, for example, who is actually stable and you can actually adjust their settings a little bit up and they appear to be improving, those types of things are obviously appropriate, probably indications for that. Exacerbations that are expected to have a rapid reversal. So in other words, we may have some patients who actually, you know, have an asthma exacerbation or congestive heart failure underneath this viral load that they're getting from COVID-19, but you suspect that, hey, if you treat them appropriately, you should be able to get them off of this fairly quickly. Extubation failure, so, or a high risk for reintubation. And so if you're trying to get them off the ventilator sooner because we have a ventilator shortage, for example, then maybe that would be an indication. But again, we'd like for it to have attending kind of the highest level of approval in those situations. So let's pause for a second and review high-flow nasal cannula, because it's kind of a fairly new therapy within the last 5 to 10 years that we're actually learning quite a bit about. And it's actually recommended over non-invasive ventilation because non-invasive ventilation in this patient population, particularly ARDS, has a low success rate. And so one of the things we're often concerned about is just them progressing towards intubation anyway, and non-invasive not helping them. Whereas half-life nasal cannula has actually been shown to be beneficial in the milder cases, mild to moderate cases, in which it may be helpful. One of the reasons that we think that it works so well is that actually, if you look here on this diagram here, this is a flow and turbulence. And so what happens is when you run these nasal cannulas at ultra high flows, like 30 liters, 40 liters a minute, you actually get this swirling effect where it actually washes out all this space here, which is kind of dead space. In other words, we're ventilating it, but it's not perfusing, those types of things. We can actually wash out the CO2 that's on exhalation and coming out and fill this with CO2 free gas, as well as a higher level of oxygen as well. And it may provide a little bit lower levels of pressure as well, particularly on exhalation. You can imagine if you're exhaling against this this flow, it may be provide a little bit of positive pressure as well. And so it appears to basically wash dead space out from the epiglottis up. And so we call this extra thoracic dead space washout. And so we actually wash all this space that normally has, 5 to 8% CO2 during exhalation with CO2 free gas. And so what we want to try to do is use the minimum amount of flow possible, because again, this is creating a aerosol. And so we want to keep the SATs kind of just greater than 88 to no more than 94. A lot of times if you're greater than 94, then you may have opportunities to wean the flow rates and those types of things. And so we suggest potentially that flow rates under 30 may be actually better. But, many of these devices can deliver 40, 50, 60 liters a minute. And so, we want to also titrate the FiO2 as well to maintain that SAT of 88 to 94. And so you want to make sure that there's a proper fit of this nasal cannula itself. In other words, if there's plenty of space around it, you do not want it to necessarily occlude, because then it won't be able to wash out a lot of times. And then after you initiate it, you need to have the patient assessed, usually about 1 hour to maybe 3 hours as well, to determine if, hey, this is working, or no, it's not working and we should go ahead and intubate. And the biggest point that we want here is that we don't want to delay intubation for lack of improvement. And so a lot of times we think, hey, well, they're doing okay and those types of things, and then they end up crumping at the most inopportune time. Additionally, since this is an aerosol generating procedure, we would like to have a loose fitting surgical mask on it. That just basically helps the aerosols impact into the mask itself, so that there is less opportunity for it to get into the environment. And so it stays with the mask or with the patient. When it comes to these devices, they come in all shapes and sizes, everything from as simple as a flow meter to a blender that's run through a humidifier that's connected to a nasal cannula. And so, but typically we need a gas source, we need a blender, and a flow meter that does, 40 to 60 liters a minute on the high side. An FiO2 analyzer like you see here, where it's just reading out what is being delivered. A humidifier is pretty important, because if you were to put dry gas, unheated gas at that high of a flow rate in the nasal mucosa, that would actually have a pretty painful effect. In other words, it would dry it out and cause lots of problems. And so we want to try to avoid that as well. And the humidification from this device, we are told that the COVID patient population tends to have really thick secretions and those types of things. And so maybe the humidification may actually be beneficial as well. And then once again, this is an example of the surgical mask just kind of loosely fitting over top of the half-flow nasal cannula device. All right, let's switch gears to non-invasive. And so I'm kind of doing it in the order of priority. And so half-flow nasal cannula, if the patient needs assistance, but not quite to the intubation period, we would do half-flow nasal cannula. And if you get a proper patient selection for non-invasive, then this is kind of how it works. And so it provides ventilatory assistance to help unload respiratory muscles, kind of first and foremost. A lot of times is that your patient has a really high work of breathing, then a lot of times you can actually give them a little bit of a positive pressure assistance. And then additionally, if they're hypoxic, which we know that this patient population is quite hypoxic, it may be able to increase your lung volume so that the oxygen can be delivered a little bit easier and more efficiently. And then successful kind of uses of non-invasive typically require that they can maintain their airway. This is something that's pretty important. If they have a decreased level of consciousness and those types of things, then and have a weak kind of respiratory drive, these are typically not your patients. You should just progress to intubation. And then last but not least is facial abnormalities that would prohibit a mask seal. We are recommending a full face mask instead of just a nasal mask. A lot of times we may actually start out with a nasal mask, but in this population, because of the aerosols generated, we would really like to strongly recommend a full face mask. Typical settings is a spontaneous mode, like a pressure support mode, as we would often call it. You have peak airway pressures of anywhere from as low as 8 to as high as 20. Tend not to go above 20 a lot of times because you can actually get some gastric distension from using that much pressure. And then CPAP and or PEEP levels a lot of times range from 5 to 15. So some simple rules of thumb is that if you need more ventilation, more CO2 removal, your CO2's high, those types of things, you tend to adjust the peak inspiratory pressure or the delta pressure, so that difference between the CPAP and the peak inspiratory pressure. If you need better oxygenation, you need more lung volumes, larger lung volumes, those types of things, we tend to adjust the CPAP or PEEP level. Typical starting pressures are a lot of times, we tend to start low and move up. And so the inspiratory pressure, the IPAP or PIP, as some people would call it, or different devices call it, is 10, and the expiratory pressure of 5 is typically where you would start, and then the oxygen is 100%. And then you would quickly escalate up depending on what your needs were. So for example, if you needed larger lung volumes and you needed better oxygenation, so say their SATs were 88 on 100% oxygen or 87 on 100% oxygen, then you may want to go up to 8 centimeters of water pressure on the CPAP or PEEP. And then you want to just continue to titrate to effect as you continue to monitor the patient. And again, the same rules apply with this as hypolineal cannula. You want to come back and assess them an hour later. Things that you typically are looking for is, did their respiratory rate decrease? Are they oxygenating better on a lower FiO2? Those types of things that very simple, but yet very powerful and let you know the trajectory of this patient. Some common devices out there, there's several different types of brands and things like that. And it's something that, again, we may actually ask patients who actually are on this at home to bring their own device in because we may have some equipment shortages and those types of things. Many of the critical care ventilators can provide non-invasive ventilation, but we're probably going to reserve them for invasive mechanical ventilation for those types of things. The requirements are often an FiO2 of 21% to 100%, and typically we're going to be starting in on the higher end of that. The ability to do those levels that I told you of CPAP and bi-level. And then we also like to have circuits that will allow you to filter those gases. Again, if aerosols are generated, then we want to be able to capture those and keep those from contaminating the room environment. And then, as I mentioned before, full face mask capabilities. Some of the limitations of non-invasive in the COVID-19 patient is obviously the potential for aerosol generation. Some of the devices, so if we ask a patient to bring in their home device, they may not be able to provide as high of a level of oxygen. So some of them you actually have to bleed in oxygen and you may be able to get 40% oxygen and those types of things, but certainly not 100%. And many of these patients with COVID-19 are really hypoxic and need those higher levels of oxygen until we can get their pressure sorted out. And then circuit configurations is the ability to add humidity or not, to filter or not, even mask. Some of the masks that come with these devices have little holes in them. And I actually have a little video about that of trying not to use those because those are almost impossible to filter.